Welcome to John Lewis 3D Learning. In this presentation, we are going to see acid, bases and salts in 10th standard chemistry. The topic is general properties of salts. So the first property is electrovalent. So almost all the salts are electrovalent in nature. That means they are formed by ionic bond. The second property is they conduct electricity. So in molten state or in an aqueous state, they all conduct electricity. That is, when it dissolved in water or when they are melted, they can easily conduct electricity. So they are non-volatile in nature. That means what? When it is heated, it cannot be evaporated. Then they are soluble in water, and the solubility also varies at different temperature, and all the salts will not be dissolving to the same extent. Every salt has got its own solubility rate, and the solubility may vary from salt to salt. And when the temperature changes for the same salt, the solubility changes. So we will see them in detail in the upcoming slides. Then the last one, exhibit acidic or basic or neutral nature. So the salt formed from acid and bases may be acidic or may be basic or may be neutral. So when that will be acidic, when that will be basic, when that will be neutral, what could be the reason for that, we will be learning them in the upcoming slides. Okay, so now let's see one by one. So what is the first property? So most of the salts are electrovalent in nature. That means what? So they are formed by ionic bonds. So example, sodium chloride. So in sodium chloride, what we learned, sodium has one electron in the outermost orbit and 8 electrons in the penultimate orbit, because sodium is 11, no? Sodium atomic number is 11. Therefore, nucleus, first orbit will be having 2 electrons, second orbit will be having 8 electrons, so 2 plus 8, 10, and the third orbit will be having only 1 electron. Therefore, by donating this electron, it becomes stable. And chlorine has 7 electrons in the outermost orbit, and by accepting that electron, that becomes stable. So therefore, so the salt is formed by electrovalent bond. So that's why the bond is very strong here. One donates, the other accepts. See, the other example for electrovalent compounds are magnesium oxide. So magnesium oxide salt is formed by electrovalent bond. And CaBr2, so calcium bromide. So we learnt in chemical bonding, no, for calcium chloride. So instead of chloride, I have given calcium bromide. So that's all. So calcium has 2 electrons in the outermost orbit. Each bromine has 7 electrons in the outermost orbit. Therefore, calcium can donate 1 electron each year. See, for example, here calcium has 2 electrons in the outermost orbit. Bromine has 7 electrons in the outermost orbit. Therefore, it donates 1 electron and bromine accepts this electron. Similarly, the other side, this bromine also has 7 electrons and calcium donates one of its electron to bromine and bromine accepts it. Therefore, here 2 electrovalent bonds are formed. Okay, so similarly magnesium also. Magnesium has 2 electrons in the outermost orbit and oxygen has 6 electrons in the outermost orbit. Therefore, by donating these 2 electrons, so magnesium donates its 2 outermost electron to oxygen. So oxygen, by accepting, that becomes stable. Magnesium by donating becomes stable. Therefore, these are all example for electrovalent compounds. See, almost all the salts are electrovalent in nature. So now you understand why they are electrovalent. Electrovalent means what? Ionic bond. So conduct electricity. See, how can you prove this? They conduct electricity. For example, if you take sodium chloride salt, solid salt, and you keep 2 electrodes here and you connect it through a power supply and you have a bulb in between. Okay, so now if you switch it on, the bulb will not glow. Even though it is connected to battery, it will not glow. But if you dissolve the salt in water by adding water, what will happen? Sodium chloride solid will not conduct electricity. But when you add water, it gets dissolved. So when it is in the dissolved state, so they carry current from one electrode to the other electrode, the circuit will be closed and thereby the bulb glows now. Therefore, in aqueous state, even just molten state is more than enough. Just by heating, if you melt sodium chloride, so even in the molten state they can conduct electricity, the bulb will glow then. So from this what we understand, they conduct electricity either in the molten state or in the aqueous state. And third one is non-volatile solids. See, non-volatile solids means what? See, for example, so when we worship God, we light up camphor, am I right? So the camphor salt, what happens to the camphor salt? So it evaporates, no? When you heat, this evaporates. But most of these salts are non-volatile. So for example, sodium chloride, it cannot evaporate. No vapor will be produced. For example, you take calcium bromide or magnesium oxide, they can melt. They all can melt, but they cannot they cannot be evaporated. That is what is the meaning of non-volatile solids. If any salt that can be evaporated, that is known as volatile solids. But salts are generally non-volatile solids. Sodium chloride, zinc sulfate, so I have given magnesium oxide, calcium bromide, all these things, no, they are all non-volatile in nature. And the fourth property is they are soluble in water. See, I told you, so for example, you take sodium chloride salt, the solubility a gram per liter. See, at 0 degrees Celsius, how many grams of sodium chloride dissolves here? So almost 357 or 358 grams. But at 20 degrees Celsius, it has increased to almost 360. At 40, it has reached 365 around. At 60, it has reached 370. At 100 degrees Celsius, it dissolves 390 grams per liter. That means what? So here we can see the increasing trend of the graph. That means when the temperature increases, the solubility of the salt increases. Is it clear? Okay, this is just an example. This graph shows everything. Just remember the graph and you can understand and remember the relationship. When the temperature increases, the solubility increases because the graph trend is going up. Okay, what is the last property? Exhibit acidic or basic or neutral nature. So it all depends on the salt is formed from strong acid or weak acid, or strong base or weak base. See, for example, if you take sodium chloride, so this sodium would have come from the strong base sodium hydroxide, and chloride would have come from the strong acid hydrochloric acid. How is salt formed? The positive ion from the base combines with the negative ion of the acid, thereby it forms sodium chloride. So sodium has come from strong base, chloride has come from strong acid, therefore this aqueous solution will be neutral because both had come from strong. Okay, what is the next one? Sodium carbonate. So here sodium had come from strong base sodium hydroxide, and it had come from the weak acid carbonic acid. H2CO3 is carbonic acid, hydrogen carbonate. So this is a weak acid. So carbon, the acidic, the negative ion will be weak acid and the positive ion will be strong base. Therefore when you mix it up, it will be slightly alkaline because it has obtained from strong base and weak alkali. Therefore the resulting solution will be slightly basic, that is slightly alkaline. Okay, one more example, let's see here. Ammonium nitrate. Ammonium had come from the weak base ammonium hydroxide, so this is a weak base, and nitrate would have come from nitric acid, which is a strong acid. This is a strong acid. Therefore, the salt ammonium nitrate is obtained from strong acid and weak base. Therefore, this will be slightly acidic in nature. Okay, what's the last one? Ammonium carbonate. So here, both ammonium and carbonate had come from weak base and weak acid. See, ammonium had come from the weak base ammonium hydroxide, and carbonate had come from the weak acid carbonic acid. So this is ammonium hydroxide is a weak base and carbonic acid is a weak acid. Therefore the resulting solution will be, we expect neutral because both are weak and weak. Suppose the dissociation, it all depending on how much this salt gets dissociated when dissolved in water. So how much is undissociated? It depends on the concentration of the positive ion and negative ion and the undissociated salt. So it may be neutral or may be acidic or may be alkaline. It may vary from salt to salt in this case. Hope you understood this. So what is meant by hydrolysis? What is meant by hydrolysis? Again, so if you take any salt, so the phenomenon due which the salt formed by a weak acid and strong base, or strong acid and a weak base, when they dissolve in water, they become either acidic or alkaline or what is it, neutral. You take any salt formed from weak acid and strong base, so that is what, strong base is sodium hydroxide, weak acid is, okay, we can take acetic acid, so therefore sodium acetate, CH3COO, this is sodium acetate. So sodium had come from the strong base and acetate ion had come from the weak acid, so sodium acetate. So when this is dissolved in water, when this sodium acetate salt is dissolved in water, what will happen? So it will be slightly alkaline in nature. So this is what is known as hydrolysis. This phenomenon is known as hydrolysis. Suppose you take strong acid and a weak base. Suppose you take a salt from a strong acid and a weak base. So weak base is ammonium hydroxide, therefore ammonium. Then strong acid is sulfuric acid, therefore the anion you can take sulfate, because sulfuric acid has sulfate, ammonium sulfate. So this salt had formed from the weak base ammonium hydroxide and the strong acid sulfuric acid. So ammonium sulfate. So when this dissolves in water, we will get slightly acidic character because it has obtained from the strong acid and weak base. So this phenomenon is known as hydrolysis. When the salt is dissolved in water, so that will show either the acidic character or alkaline character or neutral, or they will be neutral. So this phenomenon is known as hydrolysis. Hope you understood and everything is very clear. So sodium carbonate and ammonium sulfate. So instead of sodium carbonate, I have showed you sodium acetate. Both are same. So carbonate would have come from the weak acid, carbonic acid. So here I have taken acetate ion that had come from the acetic acid. Both are weak acids. Okay. Hope you enjoyed learning with me and you like this video lesson. If you like it, please click the like button and share it with your friends. Until we meet next time. Bye-bye.